Hello, and thank you for joining us on the Bitcoin litigation website first video. This is Attorney Bose of the Bose Law Firm. Before we get into our first lecture topic, which is legal issues facing retail marketplace, let's discuss the background of the Bose Law Firm and why we decided to initiate our Bitcoin law and cryptocurrency practice arena. Bose Law Firm was established in 1998, and from that time we have been engaged as general counsel for a defense contracting firm. We've litigated employment matters, business tort matters. We have litigated criminal defense issues in the federal court, in the U.S. District Court in Alexandria for the Eastern District of Virginia, and of course in the state courts throughout Virginia. I am quite aware of the issues of criminal defense in the financial crimes arena, the white-collar crimes arena, and quite aware of the contract laws that are applicable to online as well as internet businesses, licensing issues, and the like. So we decided that it would be prudent to put together and harness the experience on a cross-platform basis and open up our Bitcoin law and cryptocurrency practice arena. Because really, Bitcoin law and the issues surrounding Bitcoin law traverse several areas of society. First, there are, of course, the legal issues that are evident in whether Bitcoin is an accepted form of payment for goods and services. But then, once that question is answered, it becomes much more complex. Licensing issues are there, accounting issues are there, tax issues are there, liability in the way of retail businesses as well as exchanges are there. And of course, you have the good old financial crimes issues involving fraud, tax evasion, things like that. So Bitcoin law is really a culmination of various areas of the law, picking the issues that are relevant to this new digital currency platform. And I think that we all can agree, and it's a topic of discussion in many YouTube channels and blogs, of whether Bitcoin is here to stay or whether it's a balloon, bubble, or what have you. My personal belief on that issue is that we are squarely moving away from the paper currency paradigm and squarely into the digital currency format. The only thing that I would mention is that the IMF is probably reeling from the fact that Bitcoin was the first platform to gain any traction. I am certain that the movement for the global currency in the digital format was something that was envisioned being initiated by other parties other than the Bitcoin crowd. Having said that, and having said only that, let's move into the issues that are relevant for the topic today, which are: what are the legal issues that a retailer can face if accepting bitcoins as a form of payment? That's a very succinct legal query, so the answer is rather brief. It is our opinion that there is not going to be much of a distinction as far as government regulations are concerned for the business accepting bitcoins versus the business that accepts only cash. Having said that, the first thing that comes to mind is the IRS regulations that are required for cash transactions, specifically Form 8300, in the reporting of cash transactions and payments over 10,000 US dollars. Now, in just reading this material located on the IRS website itself, the question is your business filing the proper cash transaction forms? Has your business ever received a large cash payment and you were not quite sure what your reporting obligations were regarding that large payment? The general rule is that you must file Form 8300, Report of Cash Payments Over $10,000 Received in a Trade or Business, if your business receives more than $10,000 in cash from one buyer as a result of a single transaction or two or more related transactions. Now, the thing that gives me pause in this first paragraph is the use of the word cash. Now, the question comes up in lawyers' minds whether Bitcoin is indeed tantamount to a cash payment or not. Now, I'm going to play devil's advocate for a moment and say that it is not a cash payment. Well then, what is it? The Bitcoin Foundation, as well as some of the proponents of Bitcoin, inclusive of some of the attorneys that deal in the Bitcoin arena, are all pushing for government regulation as far as the acceptance of Bitcoin into the marketplace. If Bitcoin has regulations behind it, then certainly it will become more popular as a form of payment towards the retail sector, making it easier for businesses to welcome Bitcoin as an alternative form of payment to U.S. currency. As such, I can't see it going any other way but for Bitcoin to be classified as a cash payment, because that's really what we intend for Bitcoin to be, is it not? I mean, at the end of the day, Bitcoin was promulgated as an alternative cash platform or currency platform to the Federal Reserve. As such, I think that what the Bitcoin crowd would want is for it to be a alternative to U.S. currency. As such, it would be likely classified as cash. Now, the open question is one of a accounting question more than anything else. How do you know whether you have received $10,000 or more, because the fluctuating marketplace, as evidenced by Bitcoin charts, is that the price of each Bitcoin seems to be fluctuating daily. I think this, before I answer this question, let's go into a question that it was asked on one of the blogs by a business owner that was interested in knowing how he would classify the transaction for Bitcoin for accounting purposes, specifically whether it would be a cash-based transaction or an accrual-based accounting methodology. Now, for those of you that are asking what am I talking about, we're talking about the systems of accounting that are relevant to the retail marketplace and in the accounting of the transactions that that market or that business is conducting. There are two systems of accounting, specifically the cash system of accounting and the accrual system of accounting. Under the cash system of accounting, it's a system in which the accounting entries are made only when cash is received or paid. That means that you would have an earning if once the cash is given, and you would have a deduction or expense, when the cash is paid out from the business. And for purposes of simple simplifying the issue, we're really talking about, when we're talking about cash system of accounting, we're talking about cash or checks that are received, or even MasterCard, Visa, or credit card payments that are received by the business. So the business earns that amount and puts it on its books when the amount is received by the business. That is one system of accounting. The second is the accrual system of accounting. This system of accounting is more relevant to businesses that are sending out invoices. So, the definition and explanation, it is a system in which the accounting entries are made on the basis of amount having become due for payment or receipt. The words of import here is having become due. So if one was to send out an invoice from, let's say, a construction company, once that invoice is sent out, the business would, under an accrual system of accounting, count that entry as an earning, even though the invoice was not yet paid. So, as you can see, just by that scenario, it is more relevant to a business that is sending out invoices for payment rather than a retail business that generally, when dealing with its customers at least, operates on a point of transaction at the cash machine. So this cash system of accounting methodology, in which we are making an accounting entry for a earning when the cash is received, helps us to answer the question of how a business would likely be required to report the $10,000 and above transaction. It would likely be based on the point of sale. So if I am purchasing an item from a business, an online business, let's say that I'm purchasing a car from a online venue, and I send the money vis-a-vis my Bitcoin wallet online, and it costs above $10,000 US. I send the equivalent of the Bitcoins that are relevant at that time, and if the price of that item is $10,000 and above, then the reporting requirement would be facilitated. Now, what if the very next day or the very next hour, the Bitcoins, as evidenced by the Bitcoin charts, goes down and the value of the Bitcoins of the business drop down to $9,000. Does the business still have a reporting requirement of the Form 8300? I believe that they do, because as I stated, I believe that the Form 8300 is relevant not to the value of the currency or the item that's received by the business at any time other than the point of sale. So at the point of sale, if the transaction was for above $10,000, I think Form 8300 becomes relevant, even though the next hour, the value of that Bitcoin held by the business now goes down to $9,000 because of a dramatic drop in the price of the Bitcoin on the marketplace. The next issue that I think that many retailers are looking at is what tail end liability can there possibly be if I accept Bitcoins as a form of payment in my business? Said differently, let's take this hypothetical. Let's say that I am a retail business, and unbeknownst to me, a customer comes in who is a crook. And that crook had stolen, by hacking, an account of a Bitcoin holder got access to his wallet or got access to his paper wallet inside his physical wallet and obtained both keys. Well, if I accept as a retailer that transaction and I exchange performance in the way of giving out my goods or services and accepting that Bitcoin which was hacked or stolen from that customer, does the innocent party who was the victim of the hacking have any cause of action against me, the retailer, for the return of those Bitcoins? I think the clear answer to that is no. I think here we are looking at this Bitcoin transaction, and I think that the courts will come down this way on the issue. The Bitcoin transaction is tantamount to a cash transaction. As such, if I was to be a retail business and a customer came in with funds stolen from a guy down the street, am I on the hook for the return of the money, that $100 bill, let's say, that was stolen from the guy down the street? Well, I have performed my end. I gave my goods to the person that gave me, in exchange for that, for those goods, the $100 bill. And now the person down the street who had lost his wallet wants his $100 bill back from me, even though I, the business owner, gave goods away to the thief in exchange for that $100 note. As you can tell just by the way that I've presented it, I don't think that any court will entertain a cause of action against the business by the victim of the crime against the business. Now, the victim of the crime may certainly have a cause of action against the person who stole the funds, but as far as the business is concerned, I don't think that there is any tail-end liability in the way of a cause of action that can occur. Now, the only caveat that I put on the table on that issue is unless the business owner had knowledge of or reason to know that those funds were stolen. So it's not like the business owner can conspire with the hacker, in the case of Bitcoins, to sell him goods that the business owner knows, in fact, are the proceeds, those Bitcoins are the proceeds of illicit activity. There, I think that various causes of action may be applicable on a conspiracy type of basis to reel in the retail owner, but for the most part, innocent retail parties' tail-end liability seems to be more tantamount to a currency transaction, and there isn't a tail-end liability. Now, having said that, this is a new area of the law, and certainly any time that there is a new area of the law, retail sector businesses are predominantly hit with frivolous lawsuits. We're all familiar with them. We all get it. So is it prudent business to have this sign clearly displayed or clearly in the form of a notice to persons transacting with Bitcoins? Certainly. And the only difference that we would have, whereas this sign says, sorry, no cash refunds, the sign to the business accepting Bitcoins would be, sorry, no Bitcoin refunds. So this was the first of our lecture series. This one was a simple one with fairly simple legal issues. Next ones are going to be a bit more complex, and of interest to me is the notion of the litigation and liability resulting from this particular piece of litigation. Let me get to it here. The Bitcoinica piece of litigation. The notion by many people online, on YouTube channels, etc., is that Bitcoins are completely anonymous, and that if you get hacked, or if your wallet gets hacked, there, you've lost your money, you've lost your Bitcoins, and there is no way to get those back. Well, that's simply false. I think that the case, this case from the Superior Court of California in San Francisco, Brian Cartmell versus Bitcoinica LP et al., stands for the proposition that this really is going to be the template for litigation going forward for exchanges that are hacked and exchanges that are within the long-arm statutes applicable to the state courts, or the long-arm statutes applicable to federal court. This piece of litigation is based on an exchange, Bitcoinica, being hacked, and the innocent parties that held funds within Bitcoinica lost, obviously, their Bitcoins, and it was a substantial sum of money. And Bitcoinica did not return all of the Bitcoins that were stolen by the hackers. Well, the cause of action alleges five independent causes of action. The first, breach of contract. The second, open book account. The third, account stated. The fourth, negligence. And the fifth, conversion. Of interest to me is the fact that these are all very mundane, tried and true, very old, and quite jaded causes of action. They're used every day by attorneys. There's nothing novel about it. And this is, these are the causes of action that were filed against Bitcoinica for the return of the funds. I believe the prayer was for $400 or something thousand dollars. The next lecture will likely be on this topic, because it is absolutely untrue that there are no causes of action available and no remedy available to people that are the victims of a hacking incident if the hacking party can be identified. But also, in addition to the hacking party as a potential defendant in the lawsuit on the civil side, there is, of course, also the tail-end liability to the exchanges. So a subsequent topic that we will also discuss is, how do these exchanges, through the use of their terms of use and contractual relationships with their customers, protect themselves to limit the liability in the event of a unforeseen third-party criminal interjection of a hack into their system. So, I'm excited about this area of the law, as you can tell by my voice. This is our website again, bitcoinlitigation.com. You can find these videos, they will be listed down here, and we will update the videos going forward. Give us a call if you are interested in availing a consultation, if you are a retail business, or if you have any issues involving any regulatory compliance, an AML issue, an anti-money laundering issue, or a financial privacy issue, contract dispute, and God forbid, a tax evasion issue, do give us a call and we'll be glad to guide you along the right path. Phone number 703-926-3900. Email is attorneys@boeslawfirm.com. This is Attorney Bose signing off with the caveat that none of this materials should be construed as legal advice. They are informational purposes only. None of the viewers of these materials should construct themselves or believe that they are clients of the firm. The client attorney-client relationship with the Bose Law Firm does require a formalized written retainer. And I do thank you for your time on this first lecture.